I've long had a great affection for this congregation at Heathcote and Engadine. It's a very great privilege to be speaking to you today. Over the years, I've talked to students who've come from this church, and we've been very grateful to have them at college, and I hope you're appreciative of the graduates that we've sent to you. It's been this mutual relationship between you and Moore College, and it's a relationship that we value immensely. Over the years, I've known lots of people come from this church, lots of people who've benefited from these churches, and think back to some very dear friends. Brian Kelly, I went through college with. Dave Andrew was a very dear friend. And there have been times when I've nursed students through really painful times at this church, times when they've been quite devastated by events. And at other times, I've talked to people about how wonderful it's been to be part of these congregations. So it is a great honour to be here, and at such an important time in your life, where you do have this change, you've produced a bishop, congratulations. I was at college with Rick, I don't know how you did that, but congratulations. I'm sure you will be mourning the loss of Rick, but I've got some very dear friends, people who went through college who are now in the Armidale Diocese, and they're very much looking forward to Rick and his arrival and his leadership. And they get Janine as well, so they did pretty well out of that deal, I reckon. Let me explain. Oh, I forgot another claim to fame in connection with this congregation. There's a three-year-old who keeps breaking into my house. He keeps opening the gate at the back of my house. I live right next door to the college lecture rooms. I'm in a house above the college bookshop, really central to the campus at college. And there's a three-year-old boy that keeps on going in onto my back deck and trying to get into my house. And his mother kind of took him on about this one day and said, why do you do that? Why do you keep on going through it? And he explained that Colin Buchanan lived in my house. So I don't know if Colin Buchanan looks like an angry pirate, but I think what it probably tells me is that when Colin came in to do some children's gigs, because I don't think I look a lot like Colin Buchanan, I certainly can't sing. Yeah, don't give me a guitar. But the... My theory is that Colin actually broke into my house when he came in for the children's thing. So I was hoping to see him today to get my laptop back. But no, really I've come to talk to you about our life together. Well, your life together. What I want to explore is the whole nature of our relationships with each other at church. And I want to explore what it means to belong to each other. If there's a motto for these two talks and what we're going to be talking about today, it comes from Romans chapter 12, verse 5. You don't need to turn there. I'm just going to quote a verse. If you're in 1 John, that's going to be the most important context. But Romans 12, 5 says, "So in Christ, we who are many form one body, and each member belongs to all the others." It's very tempting in our culture to just go to church or to do church. To kind of turn up, maybe on a very regular basis, only miss out on church when there's a very good reason, when something else comes up. But to kind of go through the motions at church. Turn up, do our bit, maybe put money in the collection plate or box or whatever you do to raise money at your church. But the New Testament keeps on telling us that there's something much more profound than that going on at church and in our relationships with each other. We're not just a club, we're not just a voluntary association of people who share an interest. We're people who are profoundly related to each other because of Jesus. If we belong to Jesus, if we're in relationship with God through him, then we're one body with each other. And we're all members of one another. And it's that whole idea, that unity that we have, and the vitality of that relationship with each other, that I want to explore today and just see how rich it is. Just how many dimensions there are to that relationship with each other, how many opportunities each of us have with one another to be doing things that encourage, build up, serve, and in the process bring glory to God in the way that we relate to each other. In a sense, I feel like I'm preaching to the converted. You obviously go to church at Heathcote Engadine to be here. You're obviously committed enough to come away here. In some ways, I want to remind you of just how important it is that you keep on making this kind of commitment to being with each other and to building up relationships with each other. But in a sense, what I also want to call you to is to seize the opportunity today to be talking with each other, building relationships and taking it to another level, to be getting alongside each other in relationships so that you can be a real help to each other and make a real difference in each other's lives. There still may be people here for whom going to church is a kind of convenience thing. It suits you at this stage of your life, the way things have worked out with your kids, they're sort of happy at Sunday school or in a youth group, and so you're along out of convenience as much as anything. And today, as we speak, I'd like to move you in the direction, as you hear God's word, of it being much more a matter of conviction, of having a real sense of God's purpose for you at church, and a real sense of purpose in relationship with people around you at church. The way I've structured the two talks is to ask two very common questions. The first one is, must I go to church? And the second question is, must I get involved? And I want to try to work out answers to that question. I know, must I go to church? Seems like an obvious question. But I can think of times when people have said to me, you don't need to go to church to be a Christian, do you? And I've wanted to agree with them. When I was a minister out at Mount Druitt, preparing people for baptism, people would come wanting their children to be baptised or to have a Thanksgiving service, or maybe they were coming to me to prepare for marriage, and I'd explain to them the nature of the gospel. I'd explain to them what God had done in Jesus, what that meant for us, and would explain to them that, you know, it'd be great to come along to church. And it was interesting because people who'd shown absolutely no interest in theology up to that point suddenly became expert theologians and could point out to me that you didn't need to go to church to be a Christian. And I was often, in those early days, tempted to agree with them. I was tempted to go, yeah, that's true. You don't have to belong to Mother Church to have a relationship with God. The church doesn't mediate your relationship with God. It's not like you have a legalistic obligation to be at church every week in order to have a relationship with the God. In the gospel, God relates to us directly. We come into a relationship with God where Jesus mediates the relationship. We go straight to the Father through him. Very often I was up against people with a very religious background, a Roman Catholic background, an Anglican background, and I wanted to cut through all that church stuff and go, no, it's about a relationship with God. It's about a relationship with God. And yet, often I felt like I'd sold them short, in that I hadn't helped them to understand just how significant church is, just how important in God's purposes they are, that that's something that's absolutely at the centre of what God's doing in the world and what matters to God in the world, that we gather together as his people, that we love each other and support each other. And the passage that we'll look at in 1 John will highlight why that's such a problem. My tendency to agree with people and go, oh yeah, no, you don't need to go to church to be a Christian. It kind of helps, but yeah, you don't have to. I'll show you from 1 John a passage that kind of hit me right between the eyes and convicted me of just how mistaken I was to react like that. At the heart of our approach in these two talks is that I want to explore one another sayings in the New Testament. That's one of the reasons that we've gone to this passage in 1 John. There's a very important one another statement there. And from there, we'll open up into the rest of the book. A few other things that this part of the Bible has to say to us. But the reason that I want to focus on these one another statements is partly because of the time you're at in your life as a church. We're going to talk about loving one another, serving one another, building one another, encouraging one another, accepting one another, forgiving one another. The list will go on and on by the time we're finished. I will go on and on by the time I'm finished today. It's just one little Greek word in the original language. In English it takes a couple of words, but in Greek there was just one word to capture that mutual, reciprocal relationship that we have. It's a relationship that we're all called into, and the reason I want to focus on that word and that relationship is because as we speak about these things, I'm speaking to everybody in the room. I'm not just speaking to leaders at any point during the day. I mean, it turns out you don't have many left. I understand Ben's under strict instructions to turn off the lights when he leaves. So, you know, good luck to him. And he's not looking too frazzled yet, but when does Rick finish? All the best. No, you'll have a lot of fun. And I won't be addressing just leaders. I won't be addressing people who have special responsibilities, people who have special roles at church, particularly. What I say will be relevant to those people, but it'll be just as relevant to everybody else. There's nothing that I'll say today that is relevant to a man in a way that it's not relevant to a woman, and vice versa. That's the nature of these statements. They're mutual, reciprocal, obligation, responsibility, privilege words. They set us up in a relationship with each other as brothers and sisters, where both of us have a responsibility on both sides of the relationship. So please be listening, because at no time will I be thinking that I'm talking to anybody but you. And as a result, I hope you'll take that very seriously, and more importantly, hear God speaking. Let's have a look at 1 John and what it's got to say. Because in terms of that question that I put at the beginning, must I go to church? And the argument that you don't really need to go to church to be a Christian, which at one level I want to agree with, and yet 1 John calls that straight away and shows me just how central our relationships with each other at church are. Let me read again 1 John 1. When I first read this passage, it hit me between the eyes, and I was sure it was wrong. I was sure I'd misread it. I'm going to read it the way that I think it should go. I don't often do that with the Bible, but I'm going to read it the way that I think it should go, and you see if you can pick up what I found very hard to come to terms with. This is the message we have heard from him and declare to you: God is light. In him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him, yet we walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live by the truth. But if we walk in the light, as he is in the light, we have fellowship with him, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin. Now, did you notice where I didn't quite get the passage right? You see, this passage sounds to me just like gospel presentations that I was taught as a young man. Gospel presentations that I've taught to other people. Simple summaries of the Christian message, two ways to live, various other kind of presentations, but where we've sat down and gone, what are the bare basics of the gospel and how do I explain that to someone? How do I explain to them what it means to come into a relationship with God through Christ? You can see the elements that are there. It's that message that we're so familiar with. God is holy. The presentation I was taught was that God was the creator of the world, that it was his world. He made it. This is a little bit different. God is holy, but it's clear the point that's being made. This is God's universe. He's the creator of the universe. You have to live by his rules. He won't tolerate sin. He doesn't put up with rebellion and people ignoring him. The passage in verse 8 goes on to make very clear that we've messed up. We've refused to live under God's rule. And it's so much a part of us that we're never free of sin. We're never free of this bias towards walking away from God, turning our back on God. That's always characteristic of us. But certainly as unbelievers, that's absolutely basic to our nature. That's what defines us. We are creatures in rebellion against our Creator. He is light. We love darkness. We're not like the plants on my back deck that go reaching for the sunlight, knowing that that's how they grow, that's how they stay alive. We're more like cockroaches. That when God's light, when God's righteousness shines into our lives, we're more likely to scurry away and find a dark place. Because we love darkness. We love the things that we can get away with in the darkness. We love people not knowing what we're really up to, what we're really thinking. We love the cover of darkness when we're talking about people behind their back, when we're lying to people so they'll think better of us. We're addicted to the darkness, and God is light, and that's a serious problem. That's a big issue that only Jesus can deal with. Jesus came and took our punishment. Jesus came as an atonement for our sin. We can be washed clean by Jesus' blood, because the perfect, righteous Son of God, the perfect human being who always walked in God's light, was willing to lay down his life for us. And as a result, we can be washed clean. This is the wonder of the Christian message. This is the wonder of the gospel. You can be washed clean, so there's no longer that incompatibility between you and God. Darkness and light, like oil and water, unable to mix. Jesus has washed you clean, made it possible for you to walk in God's light and be in relationship with Him. What that means is anyone who believes in Jesus can be washed clean, can be forgiven their sins. And that runs like a refrain through this passage. Verse 7, verse 9, chapter 2, verse 2. Because of Jesus, if we put our trust in Him, we can be washed clean, forgiven. We can walk in God's light and in relationship with Him, in fellowship with Him. That's the gospel message I was taught. That's the kind of gospel message that I'd be looking to share with people if I had the opportunity to talk to them. We went on college mission not long ago, just a week ago. And that was the kind of message that we were taking to people and explaining to people. And yet, we've missed something, haven't we? There's something that's not there. When I was sort of taught how to explain the gospel, it was always a kind of afterthought. It was kind of an afterword. By the way, if you respond to this message, we ought to talk about church because church is an important part of the Christian life. It's one of the main ways that God looks after us and shows His grace to us, continues to nurture us in our Christian life. It's important that you make a commitment to church, but it was always a kind of add-on. And yet look again at the way John speaks. For him, it's absolutely integral, absolutely central. It's kind of a reflex for him. As he explains that same gospel message that we're so used to, right at the heart of it is that it's God's purpose in dealing with our sin to bring us into a relationship with each other. Absolutely central. This is no optional extra. This is not something that's nice if you can get it, to be in close, intimate relationship with other Christian people. It's not something that you fit in your life if you're enjoying church and, you know, it's kind of going well and you want to take the next step. This is right there, integral and central to God's purposes for us. And we could go back through the Old Testament and just trace that through. How much God longed to have a people that were His own. How much He wanted to gather them together so that they could worship Him. Not only in that vertical relationship, but to draw them into a relationship where they loved each other, supported each other, cared for each other. What are the two great commandments? To love God with all our heart and soul and mind and body, and love our neighbour as ourselves. And as Christians, as we're drawn into Christian communities, we have special obligations, special commitments to our brothers and sisters. Now, in case you thought that was a bit of a throwaway line and, you know, we shouldn't make too much of it, come with me and look at some other verses in John, 1 John, as we read on. Have a look at 1 John chapter 2, verse 10. John will supply a number of tests for us to reassure ourselves that our faith is genuine. One will relate to whether we believe in Jesus in an orthodox way, whether we understand Jesus rightly. Another test will be whether we're obedient to God. But one of the other key test is that we love our brothers and sisters. And John is very, very serious about this. Have a look at John chapter 2, verse 10. And it's a very fine print Bible. Who's got John chapter 2, verse 10? Who can read it out? Yeah, Tom.
Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him to make him stumble.
Yeah. Whoever loves his brother lives in the light. This is a test of whether you're actually in the light of God. If we've been forgiven by Jesus, if we've been washed clean by Jesus, and we're claiming to walk in God's light, it's absolutely basic that we love our brothers and sisters. You can't claim to be walking in God's light. You can't claim to know God and be in a relationship with God unless it's being expressed in a genuine love for your brothers and sisters. John's not talking about just greeting them each Sunday warmly and catching up with how they're going, seeing how work's been this week or how their children are going. John's talking about something more costly, more engaged, more sacrificial than that. That'll become clear in the letter. What about the next verse? Who's got John 3:14 and can read it out in a loud voice?
Yet we know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death.
Now do you get that? Do you see how serious that is? What an acid test it is. If we're not committed to loving our brothers and sisters the way that John envisages, the way that he's talking, then we can't claim to be alive in God. We remain in death. It's that serious. It's that crucial. It's not like you can sustain this vertical relationship with God and walk with the Lord and have a great time being in God's presence and knowing his love and guidance in your life, but then be ignoring your brothers and sisters. Or even holding back from your brothers and sisters, keeping them at arm's length. It's not just about not doing them harm negatively. John's talking about a positive commitment to engaging with people in love. What about 1 John 4:12? Again, do you see what's at stake? The question is whether God lives in us. The acid test, one of the acid tests, John will state it very boldly, there'll be other things that are important, but here he's willing to say, no one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us. And when we're living like that, God's love for us has come to fruition. It's come to completeness. It's one of the goals of God loving us, is that that love will then extend into our relationships with each other. You can see how serious it is for John that we take this seriously in our own lives. This isn't something we can afford to sit loose with. This isn't something we can kind of go, my work commitments don't allow me to do this. Or, oh yeah, I've had so much on with my sporting commitments that, you know, I just haven't been able to kind of keep up with this. It's okay, you know, I've tried to get to church when I can. That isn't the way John envisages the Christian life at all. If we've been gripped by God's love, if we've been gripped by God's grace, if we've been forgiven and washed clean and are in a relationship with God, then inevitably that will flow into a relationship. If that's really happened to us, it ought to flow into our relationships with each other. And over this rest of this day, the next talk in a bit, I want to just begin to unpack, well, what does that look like? Love is one of those words we bandy around by the time you've listened to the radio for a while, depending on which radio national, I don't get a lot of love songs. But by the time you've listened to commercial radio for a little while, you know, the word love has just been left kind of empty. And what does it mean? I love watching Michael Clark bat. I love chocolate. I love going for long walks. This isn't advertising for a relationship, but I love long walks on the beach. I love, you know, by the time you've used the word in that variety of ways, what does it really, and what does it mean to love our brothers and sisters? What does that look like? Well, that's what we'll try to unpack. And we'll do it by these one another sayings. And the first one I want to look at beyond 1 John is Romans 15 verse 7. And the call there for us to accept one another. I want to look at the rest of this talk at two great pillars of what we owe each other. If we've been grabbed by God's grace and our life has been transformed by him and we're living in relationship with the living God through Christ, then these are two fundamental pillars of the way we'll relate to each other with our Christian brothers and sisters. The first one is that we'll accept one another, and the second one is that we'll forgive one another. And what we'll find is to understand why John is so serious about us loving one another, why the New Testament takes this so seriously. When we become one of God's children, we become part of his family. You can't be one of God's children without being drawn into relationships with brothers and sisters. And as we relate to each other, we need to show the family likeness. We need to let the divine DNA work itself out in the way we treat each other, the way we relate to each other. We're drawn into a profound fellowship with each other. Again, it's not the loose association of a club. It's a family. God's family. And as we try to work out how do we relate to each other, how do we love each other, we need to learn to treat each other the way God has treated us. To learn from the way God relates to us in the gospel. To know what love looks like. And its heart is, on one hand, acceptance. We're told in Romans 15:7, at the end of a section, accept one another then, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. If you go back to the beginning of chapter 14, this is what Paul's been on about right through chapter 14 and 15. He began chapter 14 with, accept him whose faith is weak, without passing judgment on disputable matters. And then he'll close up in 15:7 with, accept one another, then just as Christ accepted you. And what Paul's calling us to do is stop for a moment and reflect on what it meant for Jesus to accept us. Think back to what we said about light and dark. Think back to the way that we turned our back on God, the way we resist his purposes, the way we accept good gifts from his hand. We take life and breath and everything that he gives us, and then we live in the world as if it belongs to ours, to manipulate for our purposes, our gain, our satisfaction. That's the way we've lived our lives. As unbelievers, that was the character of our life, that we were rebelling against God. And yet Jesus is willing to accept us into his family. He who never did anything against God's will, never disobeyed God, never turned his back on God, never walked into the darkness the way that we do, is now willing to throw his arms wide open and accept us and go, you can be in the family. You can share my inheritance. You can inherit the universe with me. It rightly belongs to me, but I'm willing to share it with you because I welcome you into the family. And Paul takes that principle and goes, think of how Jesus treated you. Think of the amazing generosity that he's shown in welcoming you into his family. And now you have to transpose that into your relationships with people around you. And in the chapter that we're looking at, Romans 14, early part of 15, Paul's taking on one of the great social divides in human history. The divide basically between Jew and Gentile. And the kinds of differences that that great divide generated in the way they approached things like food, observing the Sabbath. It just worked its way out in so many ways. For Jews, they'd clung to those things for centuries as the distinctive markers of them as God's people. The ones that had been accepted by God, chosen by God, and the Gentiles were regarded as outside of that relationship, unacceptable to God, and they didn't have those distinctive cultural markers. And now Paul is saying to those people, you need to bury those differences. Even if one person continues to keep the Sabbath in a certain way on a certain day, even if someone chooses to eat particular foods, that doesn't break the relationship. You accept them. You love them. Because regardless of how they do those things, Jesus has accepted them into his family. And if Jesus was willing to do that, you need to do that. I've been in churches where people have refused to accept each other over a whole range of reasons. Where some people sent their kids to school. How some people disciplined their children. I've seen churches divided over what version of the Bible they prefer. Or whether they have songs on overhead or in books. I've seen churches divided over styles of music. I've seen churches divided over all kinds of things where people have been unwilling to put this principle into practice. So I want to ask you as a congregation, who do you struggle to accept? Who struggles to be welcomed into your fellowship? Who, because of their cultural differences, their appearance, their kind of Christian background maybe, do you struggle to warmly welcome and communicate your acceptance to. Because this is fundamental. You need to stop and think, what did it mean for Jesus to accept me? And that has to translate into how you treat one another, even where there are differences that just drive you crazy. If Christ has accepted that person, then you must accept that person. Second great pillar of our relationships together is forgiveness. If you turn to Ephesians 4, one of my favourite parts of the Bible, and I'm sure I'm able to find it. Yeah, Ephesians 4, verse 32 to 5:2. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other just as in Christ God forgave you. Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. Do you see the way that Jesus sets the standard for our behaviour, for our lives? And he sets the standard for our relationships with each other. Now, I don't know what kind of heartache you've been through at church. I know enough about your church to know there have been some really damaging and painful times at church. And I don't know to what extent you've been caught up in those, but I know very little really about your life together. And I'm sure there are people here who have been hurt, offended, would feel that they've been mistreated. I never go anywhere to speak when I touch on issues of people's pain and heartache where I don't hear a flood of stories of a church that people have just come from or an experience that people have that's kind of shaped them and meant that they're reluctant to get too involved because they don't want to take the risk because of what happened on another occasion. Church, by its very nature, is a place where you can expect to be hurt. Partly because we bring such high expectations. Partly because we want to live for the ideal of church, even though that ideal won't be realised until Jesus returns and gathers his people together finally into that great gathering of all people that belong to him. But in the meantime, we can expect to be a church where sinners come, where people make mistakes, mess up, or continue to act selfishly, and we'll be on the receiving end of that. But unlike any other organisation, unlike any club, we've got a mechanism for putting those things right. We've got a way of addressing those things that really does address them. Because Jesus was willing to die for us, God is willing to forgive us. And on that basis, we need to be people who are willing to forgive. I want you to stop and think about your darkest moments. I'm not going to out you. I'm not going to get you to do a confession time. Don't worry about that. But I want you to stop and think about what it's meant for God to forgive you. Think of your perversity as an unbeliever. Think of your willfulness. Think of the ways in which you mistreated God and his creation and the people in your life. Think of the terrible things you've said to people, terrible things you've thought, terrible things you've done to people, those moments of kind of rash violence where you've lost your temper or where you've abused people in ways that you're just ashamed of. And think of the way some of those patterns have persisted in your life as a Christian. Think about your sexual immorality, your lust. Think about your deceit, your lies. Just stop for a moment. I'm not going to leave you there. But just remember what God was willing to forgive you. Just think about that. Where would you be if God was not prepared to forgive you? If he kept a record of wrongs with you? But that isn't what he's done, is it? You'd have no hope, you'd have no life, you'd have no God. But instead, you walk in God's light. You have a relationship with him through his Son. You can look forward confidently to life with God forever in the new heavens and the new earth. And now God says, pay very careful attention to how I treated you. And in those relationships, in those situations where you desperately want to hold on to a hurt or an offensive comment, some kind of slight that you perceived, you need to deal with it. You need to work it out. You need to seek reconciliation with that person. If you know that you need to go and ask someone for their forgiveness because of something you've done, then do that. Don't delay. If you need to go to someone and go, look, you might not remember this, but I was hurt really badly by you at one stage, and I've really struggled with that, and I'm prepared to forgive you. I just want, you know, I want you to understand the hurt that you did, and I want to know that you're sorry for that. But I'm willing to forgive you because they're the rules I live by. That's the world I live in. The whole point of being Christian is I want to live in the world of forgiveness. I don't want to live in the world of just desserts. And if you want to be a person who lives in the world of forgiveness, then you have to live by forgiveness. Jesus' most chilling story, I reckon, is in Matthew 18, where he tells the story of a man who owed his master a huge debt. And remarkably, the master is willing to wipe away that debt, millions and millions of dollars. He's willing to say to the person, don't worry about it, I'm willing to forget that, you don't owe me anything. And as that person leaves his master, he sees someone who owes him a much smaller amount of money. He grabs him by the scruff of the neck and goes, you better pay up, you jerk. You owe me money. And when the master hears about it, the master goes, oh, no, 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 no. That isn't how it works here. I was willing to forgive you a massive amount of money. You can't then turn around and prosecute someone for something much smaller and demand that they face the consequences. It's an example of shocking ingratitude on our part when we live like that, and it's a sign that we haven't really understood the way God has loved us and forgiven us. So in conclusion, if you've put your faith in the Lord Jesus, if you've recognized your sin, the reality of that, and the fact that you can't deal with that, put your trust in the Lord Jesus and ask for forgiveness, then you belong to Christ. God is willing to forgive you and welcome you into his family and walk with you in fellowship in his righteous, just, holy light. It's an astonishing thing. If that's true for you, then you've also belonged to each other. You're also drawn into a relationship with brothers and sisters as members one of another, part of God's family. And as his family, you need to bear the family likeness. You need to accept those whom Christ has accepted. That needs to be a warm, genuine acceptance where you let them know that you love them and regard them as a brother or sister in Christ, regardless of huge cultural differences, big differences in how you'd like to practice your faith even. If Christ has accepted that person, you are duty-bound to accept them as well. But you're also bound to forgive one another, to deal with the wrong that gets done from time to time in Christian fellowship, to go and before the sun goes down, address the issue and put things right. And that's my initial challenge for you today, to take those two pillars seriously, to search your heart for where you're reluctant to accept people that you know Christ has accepted, or where you hold on to something that really needs to be forgiven, needs to be addressed, where you need to seek reconciliation with a brother or sister because you belong to each other and because you live in the kingdom of forgiveness. And in that kingdom, the citizens are people who seek reconciliation, seek to forgive and be forgiven when we do wrong to one another. It's an awesome, awesome privilege. It's the most exciting thing in the world, really, to be caught up into God's eternal purposes. To have God transforming us individually, but then to do that in the company of each other, where we kind of knock each other into shape as Christian brothers and sisters. We're going to talk more about the way in which we bear one another's burdens in the second talk. But at the end of this talk, two great pillars of what it means to love one another, acceptance and forgiveness. Let me pray that God will give us strength to pursue those two things. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we want to be people who accept those whom you've accepted with warm, genuine love and affection. And we want to be people who address the damage that's been done, the hurt that's been caused, the careless actions that have had consequences for our relationship with people. We want to be people who address those things and seek to apply the gospel of forgiveness in those situations. Father, please help us to search our hearts and to seek to take action in those two areas. We ask that for Jesus' sake. Amen.